I'm just kind of walking. You did have the verbiage down.
That's right. The Energy and Sustainability Committee will be recorded via video and audio, and this is by virtue of making informed consent for anyone who will be speaking with us today.
Thank you very much. Okay, so first, would someone want to be a scribe?
I did the top.
My late provision of the notes, I think, should count me out. but I'm happy to do it again.
I'm fine with you doing it again.
I'm happy.
We don't hold it against me.
Exactly. You do eventually get it.
Great. You want to get your student on.
Exactly. Count this as like a
penance.
A full, yeah, that's right. Either penance or it shows my goodwill.
Great. First of public commentary, do we have someone from the public who would like to present to us?
Thank you. My name is John Gaustad, G-A-U-S-T-A-D-E. I'll be writing it down. I live at 20 Ward Avenue in Northampton, where I have lived for the last 14 years. After my retirement as a professor of astronomy, half my career at University of California, Berkeley, and half at Swarthmore College. A couple of years ago, I spoke to the city council on a similar issue. There, it really was as an astronomer because my issue was preservation of the dark sky so we could see what our universe looks like. Today, however, I'm here as a senior citizen, obviously, and a grandfather, and the issues are two. The fifth one, I think, on this list, purchasing city street lights for LED upgrade. And the issues are two, as a senior citizen, I do have some concern with safety of walking at night. I can't run away as fast as I used to. And therefore, I'm concerned that we don't have excess bright lighting on our paths and streets because of too bright lighting and improperly shielded lighting produces glare, which affects one's eyes, particularly an older person's eyes, and makes them changes their dark adaptation so that it is harder to see what's going on in the dimly lit places around. The second issue is, as a grandfather, I'm very concerned with the climate change issue and the preservation of our planet for my grandchildren and further descendants. And therefore, I advocate for using as little energy as possible for the task at hand so as to reduce the amount of carbon fuels that we burn to generate that energy. And therefore, I want to urge you, before you make a decision on this point, that if you haven't been able to already, read the letter from Professor Lowenthal, which describes in perhaps excessive detail the problems involved and the benefits and the things that are in that proposal that are very good. And his conclusion, I've read his letter, and his conclusion that though there are many very good parts of this proposal, we could do much better with the modern technology that is now available. And so I hope you will read that letter and think about it before reaching a decision on this issue. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you want the letter now, Chris,
that
James's letter?
Oh, sure. Yes. You want to read that as public comments?
Yeah.
Sure.
So this is from James Lowenthal. He sent it to me asking that it be read. 181 Crescent Street. Dear NASC members, it's very long, folks. Get ready. I applaud the city's efforts to save energy and money by replacing existing streetlights with new energy-efficient LED lights. I also applaud the willingness of the city to reconsider its original choice of very blue-rich white lights with coordinated color temperature, CCT, as high as 4,000 K or even 5,000 K, and instead choose 3,000 K models. In particular, I appreciate Chris Mason's hard work on this issue, especially for soliciting public feedback on the 8 test street lights recently placed in and near downtown. Someone's gonna have to take over, I can see. Here's a summary of the points articulated in greater detail below. There is significant glare, unwanted light shining directly in one's eyes from the current test models. The city should choose only those models that produce the absolute minimum glare. Better models are available than our current tests. The test streetlights appear to be unnecessarily bright. The illumination level should be reduced to the minimum level needed for each application. The move to 3000K warm lights, warm white lights, is a vast improvement over Blue Ridge 4000K or 5000K lights. But amber LEDs would be even better. They're a bit readily available and should be carefully considered. The plan to retrofit the acorn-style post-top lamps in downtown with new LED light engines is flawed. It has already been shown in the city's own test to produce glare and uplighting that does not even conform to current code. Instead, we should invest in properly designed, fully shielded, lower wattage fixtures. The choice of outdoor lighting for Northampton is crucial for several reasons. One, public health. Excessive light at night, and especially blue-rich light, is implicated in a growing number of serious diseases, including breast and prostate cancer, diabetes and obesity, as well as disruption of circadian rhythms. Melatonin, a cancer-suppressing and sleep-regulating hormone, is inhibited when the eye detects strong light, especially blue-rich. Two, public safety. Poorly shielded lights produce glare or offensive unwanted light shining directly into the eye, which temporarily blinds people in cars, on bikes, and on foot, ruins night vision, making it harder to see anything the instant one passes into a naturally darker area, and makes high contrast shadows where intruders can hide. Three, wildlife. All animals, including humans and plants, have evolved to depend on a natural 24-hour day-night cycle. Excessive light at night is linked to disruption of feeding, migration, and reproductive patterns of wildlife, including mammals, birds, and insects, and to disruption of plant growth patterns. Some species are threatened with extinction due to excessive light pollution. Four, aesthetics and historic preservation. Overbright, overblue, poorly shielded lighting is ugly and casts a prism-like pall over any city and is especially inappropriate in our historic 350-year-old town center. Five, Starry Nights. The United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization, UNESCO, states that the skies are common and universal heritage and forms an integral part of total environment that is perceived by mankind, unquote. The U.S. National Park Service considers a naturally dark, starry sky to be a natural resource that, like clean air and water, must be protected as a natural right for all. Light pollution robs every one of the view of the starry sky that countless generations of humans before us have enjoyed and marveled at, and which has inspired some of our most profound scientific and spiritual quests. Six, energy, economy, and climate. Well-designed lighting sends light only where it is wanted and needed, usually straight down. Any other light, including sideways or upwards glare, is a pure waste of energy and money in addition to the problems mentioned above. Northampton currently wastes tens of thousands of dollars a year in electricity for poorly designed streetlights. Well-designed, fully shielded, non-blue light may have an incrementally higher cost to buy and install. But because cutting the waste of poorly shielded high-glare lighting means lower wattage lights can be used, the better lights should pay for themselves within a few years. Would you like to take over reading? We're at three basic rules right at the top there.
The three basic rules of thumb for outdoor lighting. One, it should be fully shielded to point down only, not out or up. Pick up a metal can facing down, like gold, inside the can, shining down only. This is currently assessed quantitatively via the backlighting, pump lighting, glare, VUG rating. Two, it should not be too bright, only as bright as necessary for the task at hand. Excessively bright light makes it much harder to see anything else the instant one looks away. For reference, full moon light provides about 0.01 foot candles illumination, while typical Northampton street light provides more than 1 foot candle and more than 100 times brighter than blue. Three, it should not be too bright since blue light has a strongly adverse effect on human cell physiology, including melatonin suppression, disability glare, especially for the elderly. Stronger adverse effects on wildlife and much worse light pollution are immeasurably worse in cities that install blue-rich white LED streetlights. One could add a fourth rule, light should be on only when needed, since uneven light is a pure waste of energy and money. I think Typically, the test streetlights recently installed in and around downtown go only partway for satisfying rules. I urge the cities to go even further. Following the rules of thumb, one, shielding and glare. All the test lights have an up lighting, U rating of zero, meaning no light leaves the fixture above the horizon. This is great, but the current backlighting, B rating of B1, B2, and B3, for residential areas, urban core, and primary intersections, including crosswalks, respectively. More importantly, the glare ratings are G1, G2, and G3. There are three types of areas. Those twos and threes are simply too high, and we should do everything we can to bring those numbers down. Basically, we want fixtures that are better shielded, more like a cantering light, and less like a native light. Even the glare ratings, G1, corresponds to 1,800 lumens escaping from a fixture at 60 degrees to 80 degrees from the vertical, the equivalent of an 850-watt standard incandescent light bulb directly visible from over 55 feet away from a lighted mound 15 feet high. Glare ratings G2 and G3 correspond to 500 to 7,500 lumens escaping between 60 degrees from the vertical, the equivalent of standard incandescent bulbs of more than 400 watts and 600 watts respectively, shining bright in our light from nearly 60 feet away. The blinding glare produced by those lights serves no purpose. It's tempting to try to use fewer lights to illuminate wider areas and to think that spreading the light out further will smooth the light distribution to the ground, such as to avoid dark shadows and unlit sidewalks. It is a false hope. The amount of useful light falls quickly with the distance from the light fixture, generally is the inverse of the distance squared, while the glare doesn't, remaining strong even at distance, so the glare quickly dominates. There may be a concern that cutting off light sharply, say 45 degrees from the vertical, will lead to bright pools of light with dark shadows in between. But engineering recommendations from the Illuminating Engineering Society suggest the bright to dark ratio of 4-to-1 at ground level is fine for downtown areas. This can be easily met by using fixtures that do not allow any light to escape above 45 degrees from the vertical and spacing lights about four pole heights apart, such as 60 feet apart for 15-foot high pole-mounted fixtures. Much further spacing is of course appropriate for residential and rural areas. Illuminating glare allows the useful downward-facing light to do its job. Allowing glare requires yet brighter lights to offset negative effects of glare, a vicious cycle. Glare is the culprit. Meanwhile, the ambient light bouncing off buildings, sidewalks, roads, the sky, even from fully shielded light, provides more diffuse useful light than most people realize. About 30% of light striking asphalt roads is reflected right back in the neighborhood cityscape and the sky. Glare is especially dangerous where drivers desperately need to see the walkers, not the light fixture. Instead of the least restrictive G3 crosswalks, we should be aiming for the most restrictive G0. Good alternatives are available, such as the G-Evolv LED series, which has BUG ratings as low as B1, U0, G1. Other options we found at the National Dark Skies Association website. Two, brightness. Once blinding glare is minimized and the light is properly controlled, much lower lights and levels of illumination can be used safely and effectively. Some communities have found that by reducing glare, they can cut out light levels as much as 10 times or more, an enormous immediate savings in cost, energy, and greenhouse gas emissions. In most cases, once glare is controlled and fixtures with lower light levels are installed, residents don't even realize the light levels are lower. Again, glare is the culprit. Now, the city's website for press releases on LED lighting test mentioned the brightness specifications and lumens of the test lights. But judging from the BUG ratings and fixture design, the brighter ones must be at least 5,000 lumens. This will yield brightness on the ground below the fixture of well over 1 foot candle at more than 100 times brighter than full moon. These are unnecessarily bright. I have not yet had the chance to measure brightness of the test lights directly. If I'm wrong in fact, and if in fact illumination levels are already around 1 foot candles or less, the brightness levels may already be appropriate after all. It would be a mistake to simply replicate certain current high levels of illumination in and around town. brighter is not better. Ongoing research, professional illumination engineering field shows that a steady downward trend in recommended light levels, obvious benefits from for energy conservation. Meanwhile, there is no consensus, despite decades of research, that more light provides more safety, either from vehicle, from motor vehicle and bicycle crashes, or from violent crime. We have an unprecedented opportunity in Northampton to steer away from our society's historic habit of overlighting everything. Our goal for outdoor lighting is not to banish the night, it's to make the city safe and attractive. This is best served by keeping the amount of light appropriate, not too high, not too low, and the quantity of light, and the quality of light, the color and shield. Three, color. The 3000K warm white color of test lights is much, much better than blue-rich white lights, color-coordinated temperatures of 4,000, 5,000, without the lights that were first being observed for Northampton, and greatly relieved this is no longer considered a blue loss. But even the warmer, less blue color, color LEDs are available. With high efficiency and excellent color rendition, and Northampton should seriously consider using them. Those LEDs are amber and have CCT at 2700 or less. They are easier on our eyes, especially for the elderly, and they cause much less light pollution, 16 times less than blue-rich light. These have much less deleterious effects on the health of humans and wildlife than blue-rich light. Their appearance is even closer than blue LEDs to that of standard incandescent lights. The technology is already available and in use elsewhere. Light manufacturers and suppliers have proved to be very flexible in providing amber LEDs, especially when the city's entire lighting stock is up for replacement. For example, the entire city of Sherbrooke, Quebec, population 150,000, replaced all their street lights with fully shielded amber LEDs. Want to try again?
Okay, I can do two if you want.
Sorry,
how much more do we have to go?
Right here.
What page are we on?
2 of 10.
Oh, it's almost over. Here we go. It's the last page.
It's really informative.
It's very interesting.
I have four versions of this letter already in the last 2 years. So.
Smart technology. I understand that the new lights will all be capable of accepting dimming controls in the future. This is great. For example, in San Jose, California, the new fully shielded LED streetlights are actively controlled by the city so they can be dimmed or turned off when not needed, e.g. long after midnight. There are street sidewalks and bike paths in Denmark that are illuminated only when the presence of a driver, bicyclist, or pedestrian is detected. It's too bad Northampton can't implement such technology now, but kudos to the city for leaving the door open to it in the not too distant future. Acorn-style post-top streetlights. Finally, I understand that the latest plan for gas light-style acorn post-top streetlights in downtown is to replace the light engine only with 3000K LEDs, but to keep the existing acorn glass globes. It's great that they're to be 3000K and not bluer. But keeping the existing globes, even with the new down-facing LEDs, will still produce lots of disability glare and nuisance glare, and not an efficient or effective illumination of the sidewalk and streets. Such a design is not even compliant with the city's own current outdoor lighting code, which prohibits uplighting. The test on Armory Street last year demonstrated this point. See attached photos showing significant uplighting from both the old high-pressure sodium light and the new LED in the old acorn globe. Good alternatives are available, such as the ones recently installed at Smith College. See other photo attached. And I think the city should put a high priority on installing the best quality lighting possible, especially in its historic downtown. Again, the initial higher cost of the new fixtures will be offset by the lower wattage used by a more efficient downlight only design. Already, by considering the 3000K LED LED streetlights and not blue-rich white ones, Northampton is very much on the right track in protecting public health and wildlife and its natural and built environment. I urge you to keep Northampton ahead of the rest of these important curves and not behind them. Many thanks for your concerted efforts and commitment on these important projects. Sincerely, James D. Mullenthal.
Okay. I have not seen that letter. Can you forward that to me?
I will attach it to the whole committee. Or?
Oh, Oh, you can send it to the whole state.
Sure. And then I'll attach it to the minutes.
Okay, there you go, Mary. Okay. Any other public comments? I would take a motion to approve the minutes of March 10th. Okay, and David seconded. Any comments? Corrections? All in favor?
Aye.
And I didn't see anybody abstaining to that, so I guess that's an approval. Vanessa, public members. So this is basically just an announcement, but I think Bill is going to update it. I had heard that the Mary Scott and Eden have been recommended for reappointment at the May 5th council meeting. Is that accurate?
They were recommended, they came before the council at that meeting, at which point we referred it to committee. They may expect phone calls from members of the committee, at which point the committee comes back with recommendations for the appointments. I anticipate, I'm trying to think, if the committee that it was referred to actually meets by the time we have our meeting on the 19th. If that's the case, then they come with a recommendation, it'll probably be voted on for approval on the 19th. A week from today.
Okay. Okay, that would be great if that happens.
But I think it's pretty clear that members serve until replaced.
Yeah.
So it's not really an issue in question.
That's not an issue on quorum?
No.
We've had all of the mayors, we have people who serve for years. Right. This one's been more prompt, but it's
Okay, very good. I won't worry about quorum votes as much.
Right.
I wasn't quite sure where we stood on that.
The only time that became an issue was when Councilor Klein nor I were sworn in. So we were not actually elected officials, and right. As such, our position here on the committee wasn't determined yet. So that was the only instance. Everyone else serves until they're carted away.
Okay. I don't see the cart.
No, I think you're safe. We don't have money for the cart, so you'll be fine.
So there are no other applicants, no other interests?
Not that I'm aware of, but Chris would know about that. I mean,
not that I know. I asked the mayor, and I didn't hear any others. The only one that was possible would be Darren Fort, but he's moving to East Hampton, so he's he probably would have, but he's moving to East Hampton, so
that's right.
Yeah, which is unfortunate because he's been, you know, as an associate member, he's been really valuable to have.
Super handshake.
You're
okay. I'm just saying that
Okay, so Purchase City Streetlights for LED upgrade. I'd like someone to move the following motion, which I've written out very nicely, to approve the use of up to $38,000 from the Energy and Sustainability Revolving Fund for the purpose of purchasing the remaining utility-owned streetlights and associated non-distribution poles and supporting equipment, (313 lights and 117 poles, in order to enable the city to upgrade the lighting technology to high-efficiency LEDs.
So moved.
And
second.
Okay. Good. Okay. So a little background. With the city council approving funding for this project, which along with some other funds the city already has set aside for this, it brings it up to about $1 billion for the street light upgrade. The cost of the LEDs would be just under that. With a 10% contingency in there. So if we never get to that 10% contingency, that $1 million will cover the cost of purchasing the streetlights as well. If not that, then the utility rebate will certainly cover the cost. So we've got the money to do this whole thing, including the streetlight purchase. But if we need to purchase the streetlights on top of that full 10% contingency in there, and the rebate has not come in yet, the assessor may say you don't have the money to back this up. So this is basically using the Energy and Sustainability Fund to back that up so that we're ready to buy the lights, we buy the lights, and then it's all going to basically be covered either by the bond or the rebates anyhow. So that's the background. Anybody has any questions?
The money can't go back into the fund, right? Is it going to be spent and then recaptured, or?
If it's spent, it could be recaptured. Right now, the funds can be funded through the sale of SRECs and or utility rebates.
Oh, okay.
I think if it goes through utility rebates, it probably would have to come through city council. Because I think the utility rebates would go to general funds and then have to be sent back out by city council. So so it's not a guarantee that it would, but you know, that's the purpose of it. That's probably what would happen.
And Chris, because somebody may be thinking $38,000 is a large expenditure, blanking out, what's the annual dollar amount that we fund that, revolving fund at?
We get in about $38,000 a year, about $35,000 to $40,000 a year from the sale of restaurants. Any other questions, discussion? We had a motion, we have a second. All in favor? Thank you.
Can I get that language from you afterwards?
Absolutely. Okay, the outdoor lights. So I'm gonna be updating, gonna give everybody an update on both the post top lights and the street lights. Turns out that despite our best efforts to actually replace the post top lights with new fixtures, and the reason to do that was the old fixtures are not in the best shape. Just what James Lowenthal was talking about, trying to go to a true dark sky fixture. To start developing some new consistency, because those are fixtures that are going to be going into the Quasky Park. They're the fixtures that are going to be going in, they've already gone in at Bridge Street School. And yet, we learned through this process that, through the process at Pulaski Park, that the existing poles would not hold the new fixtures, or at least they, you know, the manufacturer would not want to sell them to us by putting them on the new poles. Pricing for the new poles just sent the whole project through the roof. And the payback for them is not that high for this. We do have a grant to cover the cost of the light engines, and it just got down to, you know, the only affordable thing to do at the moment is to put in the light engines. Actually, I'll bring it up since James did bring it up. He does have a point. I mean, existing lamps are grandfathered in from the dark sky ordinance. Replacing a bulb does not break the grandfather, so it's we're not going against code by replacing the fixture inside. And it's a grant-funded project, so it's really not costing the city any money. If the city did want to prioritize upgrading their outpost top outdoor lights to a new LED fixture, recognizing the fact that it would take into the cost of that adding new poles, putting in new poles all the way around, which simply means that the payback would be much worse. It's actually a significant cost. You know, the city could do it. So knowing all this, we've decided, in order to use this grant, which is about to run out, we are going to put in the light at Very good question.
I'm just curious about the poles. Is there a way to customize them so that they would be suitable? I mean, wouldn't that be cheaper? About that.
When this was identified, because we were going to put the same lights on top of the poles in Classy Park, and those poles have been removed. And we didn't know about this. We had no hint that this was the problem until Pulaski Park tried to do it, and they went through, can we refurbish the poles, can we, you know, and the answer was basically no. You would have to refurbish them and get some kind of engineering study on them to confirm the fact that they will withhold the weight of the new lamp. And that, you know, that along with the time and the grant running out kind of put the kibosh on it.
And the ones at Bridge Street were purchased fully?
They were new, right? Yeah, the poles and everything. The one place where this is an exception is that at the police, and the second reason was the poles, as they currently are, the tenon that holds the new fixture at the top is of the wrong size. But that's something that actually could be fixed, because at the police department, where the city actually did break its code by putting in lights that were not dark sky compliant, They are in this project, and those ones we are going to replace with the new fixtures. The poles were new enough. They had the tenon problem, but the manufacturer was going to work with us, and they got a tenon adapter designed. They went out and had someone design an adapter specifically for that, so that we can now put fixtures on those new poles. But those are the only new poles we have to work with, so they're the only ones we're going to be able to put on.
So it's the mounts that, I mean, and with the LED engine, do the lamps actually weigh more than the Cobra heads that are sitting there now?
Not appreciably, yeah, because they're going to take out the ballast and the lights,
right,
and they're going to put in a, no, but the new fixture would have been a whole new, it would not have been an acorn,
right.
It would have been a whole new style, and that's where the weight is, or whether the weight is that much more, the distributor would not sell it to us, you know, and take on the liability of selling us something that might fall into his head, basically, right? And so that's where it stands. I mean, it's all kind of happened quickly. The one positive is that the light engine that goes in, the new fixtures actually don't have this feature, but the light engine that we're putting in does have this feature. We can have it programmed for timed dimming. And so in every case where we've got it out there, we are going to be confirming with the police department exactly where they're okay with dimming lights, say at 1 a.m. or something like that. And we're gonna program as many of them as we can to dim down in the wee hours in the morning and then come back up before dawn. So we will get them. And that actually makes sense for us because those lights are metered. We actually measure the kilowatt hours that go to them, and so we can get monetary savings out of that as well. Whereas the street lights are done on a rate tariff, and they're going to charge us whatever they want to charge us for that tariff, regardless of whether we dim something. That's one of the reasons we didn't do with the street lights.
And there is no retrofit for shielding, because shielding seems to be the principal interest, an internal shielding device.
Well, you could, but the problem with, the light engines that are going to go in are basically, no uplight.
Right.
They're a lot more directional than what's in there right now. What's in there right now will shine in all directions from inside. What we're going to put in has a more of a downlight, but it hits the lens,
right,
and it refracts, and so it goes in all directions. Louis,
I've seen people actually take a can of black spray paint and spray paint the top of them, and it really doesn't work out very well. They lose all aesthetic value.
Right. Well, the ones we have right now, the acorns and the colonials, they all have a black top. The only one that didn't were the ones that were put in the PD.
Right.
So that one we're going to replace with, the full downlight.
When the glass covering does push the light up,
right?
No matter where the LED is.
Right. You'll notice that the ones in the park, you can actually go see them, and the ones at Bridge Street, the design there, the LEDs are up inside top.
Right.
And there's a glass plane right there, and then where you normally get the lens, there's nothing. It's open to the air. Hoping no birds go in there. That's good. but that way you eliminate the light going up from the lens. So I am really just reporting this because I don't think the city has much choice if they wanted to use the grant opportunity.
Chris, this might be a unique site, but on Strong Avenue and Pearl Street,
yes,
there's one section where you have Cobra heads on top of the period lights, like literally lighting the same spot.
Yeah. One small piece.
Yeah, two or three fixtures.
Yeah, there might be.
Can we take out the Cobra heads? Because we don't need to duplicate.
If we could, I'd be glad to do that. For me, the whole project of upgrading the streetlights, I was looking for a new technology. But the project did not encompass a whole new lighting design for the city, which was, a lot more. So what I've done, the city actually did that in the 90s. And it's not that there was someone said, here's a lighting plan. They basically try to say, if you're a residential street, you're going to get this light, and every residential street is going to get the same. You're in this situation, they're all going to be this brightness and stuff. And so the best I could do was look at the map of where the lights were and determine what that pattern was and try to imitate it. So I've tried to stay true to what the city had intended in the past. I mean, it could be that we do some kind of photometric study on that one small piece. I think it would eliminate one light, though. Yeah, I think it would take out one co-lit. Because for the most part, those are only lit by the post ops. Those are, they're not lit by co-lits. I think there's one co-lit in the same spot.
Yeah, I thought it was more of
a... Yeah. Yeah, it's not. I actually thought so, too. I actually walked the street on purpose to kind of look for the co-lit. It's not there. Yeah.
Another big factor for this project is that we're stuck with the existing poles. I mean, the way, you know, one of the big improvements you can make is put it lower and more, but we're stuck with where the poles are. We simply can't afford to add poles where they're appropriate to take poles away where they're not appropriate.
Right. If you're referring to some of the things that Jim was talking about, you know, I'm going to look at what he said.
Right.
And if there's any place that, I actually was paying quite close attention when they brought that up, and they were talking about urban lighting.
Talking
about urban lighting at that point.
It'd be great if we could do that on Main Street. It'd make it look a whole lot nicer and it'd be a lot more comfortable. But taking existing poles out and putting new lighting poles
in. Right now, I'm not sure with downtown, but in general, we tend to have lights it's not every pole. I mean, throughout the city, we don't have lights on every pole. It's like every other or every third. I can't remember up here. But I'll definitely take a look at anything Jim said. If there's a way we can drop lights anywhere, I'm happy to.
Can you also address the color issue a little bit and then talk about...
Okay, so the color issue, the reason we were going with the 4,000K, which is what was really what we were going for, not sure why Jim had mentioned 5,000K, but was because in order to get a rebate for the lights from the utility, they have to be on the Design Lights Consortium's qualified product list. And as of probably 9 months ago, the warmest color temperature on that list was 4,000K. And so that's what we were moving forward with. Since then, more and more of them have come on. As a matter of fact, the ones that we are going to have in, I cannot find them on the qualified product list yet. But Siemens tells us that they are, and I have spoken with other communities who not only have put them in, but have gotten a rebate for them. So, I think what it is there's some paperwork that has to happen, and they just haven't got put on a qualified product list, but they've been approved through that process.
What about the
amber lights? The amber lights, we asked, and when we were going away from them, we were asking Siemens to get us the lowest color temperature possible, and this is what they came back with. And I'd have to look through my notes to see if there was, you know, anything more detailed than that. But that's what we asked for. We asked for the lowest color temperature possible. And we were, you know, 2700 was mentioned to them, for sure, as the ideal light. But this is what they propose. And 3000K is pretty close to 2700. I mean, I don't know exactly the difference in color outputs, but, you know, the LED lights are going to generate far fewer lumens than the high-pressure sodiums used to generate, because the color rendition is so much more palatable to the eye that it's more useful. So there's far fewer lumens. The high pressure sodiums actually have a blue component to them that you don't tend to see because there's such a high yellow component to them. So I hear what James is saying, and then we've asked to get as close as we can. And I suppose if someone wants to make the ruling that we simply can't go forward until 2700 is available and can get a rebate, then that probably would stop the project. And, And yet, I will ask Siemens again, before we lock in on this color temperature, I will ask them, do you have a 2700, is there a 2700 K version that you can get us?
It's just it's a database, right, that lists eligible bulbs?
Yeah, design like those workshops, it is a data, yes. It's a big, huge searchable database you can get online.
Go check it out.
Design like those workshops qualified platform.
The only other question I had is, you mentioned being in touch with the police about which lights could be dimmed at a particular hour and that kind of thing. And I think that I would recommend, I mean, I think I'd like to talk a little bit more about that, because I think that if we're going to check with the police and they're going to be the final authority in deciding where to dim lights and where not to dim lights and when to dim lights or whatever that may be, law enforcement or kind of our public safety people tend to favor more light, and I don't think they're quite up to date. From at least when Russ Sinkowitz was our chief and he came and spoke to the city council, he wasn't particularly updated. I don't know if there's with the change in chief, maybe that's changed too, but he wasn't particularly updated on research that tells us that more lighting is not necessarily more safety. And so I would like us to really consider carefully where, in fact, we're when we're dimming lights, and go more in the direction of dimming lights rather than not dimming lights because of so-called safety reasons that are not proven safety reasons. Does that make sense?
Sure. Yeah, just to let you know, I actually have heard back from Chief Casper on it. And for the most part, where I wanted to dim, she was okay with. There was an exception of certain places that they know that when the bars get out at 2 in the morning, that there's certain places where there's a lot of traffic. There's a lot of people moving through, often on foot. And that's when she wanted her police officers to be able to, you know, see where people were as they were moving
right.
And that was basically it.
Yeah, so the other thing I'll just point out is, Chris and I had a discussion. Not only this, as we've had conversations with Jody about this, but we're going to talk to her about having her supervisors on the night shift drive through these streets where we have the test lights up and see what their perspective is. So we're going to be compiling a fair amount of information so we can get some good input, because these are the officers that are out there at 3 o'clock in the morning. So to look at the colors as well as the dimming factor. Mm-hmm. And they're the ones that are going to be driving the streets.
I do think there's a gap, though, between kind of science.
I'm sorry, I wanted to speak to that, because actually when Russ Sinkowitz was asked for his opinion, it was in relation to a moratorium, or enforceable ordinance moratorium requiring private enterprises to turn their lights off. And he responded by saying, essentially, he doesn't have an argument one way or the other. What he was saying was that insurance companies that protect the businesses insist on lighting, and that they're the ones whose standards were the ones he was going by. So he felt uncomfortable to try and enforce something that would actually jeopardize their ability to insure themselves. He wasn't asked to comment on municipal lighting. I think you'd find that there'd probably be, I mean, I think they'd be amenable to the conversation, discussion, and the data. But I also do think, I mean, this is spinning off of this, is that this is the issue that we've had, this ongoing conversation with Dr. Lowenthal, was the competing interests. One, the means and the revenue to have, I mean, I think we all aspire to the most ideal and optimal situation with the lowest light, warmest light possible. With, you know, we keep being shown these wonderful systems in Nordic countries that basically respond to motion and light comes on then, or that you can do color programming, you can program messaging and everything else through these systems. We don't have, I mean, clearly what we've got, $1 million sounds like a lot, but point of fact is not to completely retrofit a city with the optimal LED system. Could be different in 10 years. I mean, to Chris's point, that if we put the kibosh on this now, we can wait 10 more years and see if the funding's available and suddenly and the systems are more updated. And one of the challenges with LEDs, of course, is they last so long. So whatever you get, you got for a while. And it's like waiting for a phone upgrade. You know, do you just hold on for another 10 years for a phone that's embedded in your head, or do you go with what works for now? And I think that's the conflict that we've been trying to resolve. This is the struggle trying to, the criteria that we have to abide by in order to qualify for the grant funding, the criteria, the polls, of course, that's a new wrinkle. That's a real bummer.
Yes.
And, but I mean, you more or less anticipate some of these things as you go into a project that's significant, but I think what's important to emphasize is that everyone's intentions are aligned. It's just that Chris is constrained by actual limitations that are prescribed by grant funders, suppliers, and others, including police, that may limit his options a lot more than the ideal options that James outlined.
What I would add to that is the economics of it.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's the economics of it is
the payback and what we're calculating
right.
to be the annual savings in hard dollars.
We're looking at 5-year payback, right? 5-year payback on
for the streetlights.
For the yeah, for the streetlights.
I mean, for the post op ones, it's grant funded. So
yeah.
So okay. Pay for it,
but the annual savings in this cost for electricity for those streetlights.
Right, so you extend out that payback, the right. associated costs.
And
the community will at that point also diminishes.
And as Jim mentioned in his letter there, because he knows that we're doing this, is that we didn't ask for dimming control in the streetlights, but we did ask for the pin module that's needed to actually install a dimmer in the future.
Right.
And the reason why was that the dimming controls, Siemens actually priced them out for us. We would get no operating cost savings because the utility would charge us the same amount whether we dimmed or not. I heard the yeah, that's something we'd love to get the utility to change on. And the added cost brought it up significantly. Offhand, I can't remember, it might have gone from a 5-year payback to a 10 or 12 year payback or something like that. But it was just like, you know, we can't get the savings out of it anyhow. Let's get ourselves dimming ready. And when the utility changes, so we can start getting some payback on this. And by then, hopefully the dimming technology is actually improved and come down in price. That would be the time to go for it.
One other piece that fits into all this is that there are, I mean, James has studies, but there's also the Illuminating Engineer Society of North America, and they're one of the standards, and they put out standards, and the technology hasn't been in place long enough for them to have done the kind of assessment. And we're going, one thing that our plan is going significantly below the recommended levels of the Illuminating Engineer Society, but I think we'd want some kind of generally accepted protocol or set of criteria, set of standards. If we were gonna go to a much lower level, there's also some consideration of liability. If we significantly underlight something, based on sort of the industry accepted standard, the city might end up with some liability if someone could make the case that we were negligent by ignoring, you know, industry standards. So I think we're working awfully hard with an awful lot of constraints and that's part of why we're not getting to what James would like to have or any of us would like to have. I don't know if you've seen Newbury Street in Boston, but it's really attractive. It's low lighting, low level lighting, frequent, very low level poles. It's really attractive, and I don't know if Northampton has the wherewithal to get to that point because of sort of the costs.
Newbury Street, or rental rates. Other than that, we
house parking lot. There's shoebox fixtures there. Those are all pretty in bad shape. Those we are going to replace with new fixtures. The poles are nice metal poles. They can take these. Those will be 3000K. They will dim late at night, and they will have a motion sensor so that once they dim, if someone walks into the parking area at 2 a.m., they will come back up to brightness again. As far as moving forward on this, the city actually had an apparent low bidder that we signed a contract with to put in light engines, and then they weren't able to come up with required bond payment. So we are now nixing them and going on to the next contractor. Something else. Oh yes, I did want to mention from what David mentioned, the we had the 8 sample LED fixtures installed for the light, for the street lights. If anybody wants, I don't know if anybody had, did anybody have a chance to go see them? Here's a map of where they are. Okay, so I got 4 maps if anybody wants to. We had 90 people, about 90 people respond to that. And where I don't want to give out details, because I still want to parse some of the more hard to pull out information, because people provided comments as well as likes and dislikes. But if you look simply at the likes and dislikes, it was blatant, hands down. They liked the warm white, they did not like the white. That was like, 75-80% of people liked the warm white, 75% of 80% people did not like the white white, or the neutral white. So definitely, no big surprise there that we're going to go in that direction. But I do want to look at a little bit more. One thing that did pop out was back in the 90s, when the city kind of set everything evenly across the board, there was one piece that kind of surprised me, was that most residential areas have a certain light level, basically a 50-watt high-pressure sodium equivalent. There were some residential streets that were at 100-watt high-pressure sodium. And if you look at a map, it becomes pretty obvious that they probably did that because they're the residential streets that people use as cut-throughs during rush hour. So they're the high traffic streets. And yet, because of the feedback that we got from this survey, I'm taking a look at that again before we go down. And this is one where I do want to bring in, I've already brought in the planning departments, I've brought in some of the folks from the DPW. And I want to sit down and talk with Chief Casper about this to make sure that there's no safety reason. If there is really no safety reason to keep those residential streets at a slightly higher level, then we're going to knock those down to match everybody else. And I actually think that's what's, I shouldn't say that. I don't know yet. But we're gonna relook at that to see if we can knock down some more residential streets to a lower light level. And I will have a report out, hopefully early midweek next week, just kind of summarizing what the community said about the sample streetlights. All right, I guess that does kind of cover everything. The contract that we have with Siemens, which is not yet signed, but it's really close to being signed, allows for us to change color temperature, if we want to change lights down to a lower temperature, that would do nothing but reduce costs, increase savings, and so for those places we're looking, we're going to be able to do that with a change order. So I'm feeling comfortable that we can, I'm feeling comfortable that we are awfully close to a product, but I am going to take a look at James's letter, look wherever we can. I mean, I want to put out case in point. In reviewing the one place where I threw out what was currently existed and went with a different lighting level was in the industrial park. Because it was heavily, heavily lit, and I said, is that standard for a place where people don't even walk? There's no sidewalks. People drive there and they don't go there at night. So I looked up and sure enough, industry standards are more of a residential level. So instead of having a huge high level, we're really dropping the temperature, the brightness. We're going to get rid of half the lamps and take the rest of the lamps and just drive them way down in brightness. So that's a
an example of where we've been, you know, looking where we can to push down lights on this through this project. Again, with this project not being one to redesign the city's lighting, this is not what it's designed for. I'm done with my comments. Do we have a lot of comments? Any more from you back? Anything from? No. Okay. Great. PV on the landfill. The city has finally, yes, signed a contract with Ameresco. Took a lot of back and forth there. I will say this is for the PV on the landfill. Following the, as you all know, the state just recently upped the net metering capacity, and shortly thereafter, the OER gave a ruling on the SREC 2 program, how long they were going to keep that going. And given that, when that all came out at the same time, and Ameresco, at that point, they have a lot of projects they're working on, and they said, we have to go back and look at all the projects and see which ones make it to this deadline, because those are the ones we want to prioritize, and the other ones we're going to have a setback. Northampton's made it to the list. They think they can make it. They think we can get into the net metering capacity, and they believe we can get the project done by the end of December of this year, which means it would make it for the SREC 2 program. If it doesn't, the SREC 3 program, no one knows what kind of subsidies it's going to provide. Everybody believes it's going to be lower. So that's just really good news, and the best I can say is that Ameresco is plugging as fast and as hard as they can to get this project permitted and approved and moving forward and installed. And I would say that the city staff has got this as a high priority. When Ameresco asks for something, we immediately try to jump to get something, the signatures needed or approvals or whatever. Any questions on the landfill?
Do you have an estimated timeline?
All I can say is we're shooting to have it. It would have to be installed by December, so we're talking about, you know, through the summer, probably into the fall. The interconnection agreement is a huge time consumer, a DEP permit and stuff like that. But so that's as close as I can get off the top of my head.
DEP permits?
Yeah, because it's a landfill. Yeah. Right. Post-closure use permits. Okay, Mass state legislation on carbon emissions and energy use. I think some of the folks from Climate Action Now would be here tonight, as they've been, Sharon and Adele. But they are right now, I understand, talking with Peter Pocock at the UU Church, as we speak. But a few things, and Louie, you asked for an update on the solar.
I know that we got with one hand, and I wonder how much we gave back with the other in terms of rates and things like that.
Okay. No, we didn't give anything back on rates. What we did was we got an update, a very tiny increase in net metering capacity, basically. I personally had assumed at that point, because the state was going to be going through this huge omnibus energy bill that was supposed to include everything, that the long-term planning for solar would be in the omnibus bill. I have since learned that as far as the House is concerned, they are done with solar.
That's it. No.
They are done with solar. They are not going to do anything more. And the House is very close. And very close to passing the omnibus bill. I have also heard recently that the omnibus bill, the rumor is that it still contains approval of a tariff charge electric rate users for gas pipelines. So I would leave that open for the Energy Commission to say anything they want about it. But Climate Action Now and other activists out there are really trying to get the word out to every rep possible that if the rate tariff
for gas pipelines is in this bill, no matter what else is in this bill, kill it. Do not pass it with a rate tariff in it. If it gets declined because of that, they'll probably have to take it out to go back to the next measure. And I personally think that's an incredibly good idea. So I just want to kind of toss that out for the commission to work on. And actually, before I go into carbon fee and rebate, which would be the next piece, I'd like to leave that, you know, is our commissioners interested in somehow making that effort to our reps? Actually, you know, before I do that, what do I have here?
I'd like to see what the bills, what it is at this iteration, to see what, I mean, you know, given the recent federal court decision about Stansfield, that basically what put the kibosh on the pipeline, as we know it, was not the feds, and it wasn't the state. It was no money. No one was. There wasn't enough buy-in.
Right.
But the fact is that now the ground has been plowed even more to allow any other potential applicant after this court ruling to co-opt state protected property, land and conservation. So there any other pipeline that's considering coming or in the future, it also probably would drive legislation and corporate initiatives towards trying to expand capacity for gas, as opposed to, they may have learned something from the most recent pipeline failure, but I don't think they've been vanquished, and I don't think the whole issue is dead by any stretch. Unfortunately, a lot of people are feeling that they're spiking the ball in the end zone when in fact they're only about 20 yards away from the goal. So I, on impulse, based on what you described, yes, I would oppose. I would be keen on making sure that there's no tariff attached to that to subsidize.
And what I'm hearing is that the House Omnibus Energy Bill is expected very shortly, likely this week, maybe next week. And folks are saying it's likely that a vote will be scheduled within 12 hours of release. That's the speaker has started to show a pattern of releasing something at the end of the day. You know, when people have all basically gone home, a bill is released, and then he schedules votes as fast as he can afterwards. So the ability to look at the bill and see what's in it,
that could happen,
right? Now, we don't know what the Senate will do. You know, the Senate's gonna have to come up with their own omnibus bill. So more long-term, I thought the commission here might be very interested in continuing to be advocates for green energy. Adele did send us she sent me some feedback. She said, I think lobbying the House on including solar in the omnibus bill, energy bill, is a waste of time. The speaker has announced loud and clear that he is done with solar. And then two, we need to lobby the Senate on issues, though, hoping if they include solar in their version of an energy bill, the two branches will have to compromise, perhaps with a better outcome than last time. There is time to lobby senators, since the Senate apparently hasn't yet drafted its energy bill. And then there's a pretty widespread effort to get people just to... So what can the commission do if the commission wants to do anything on this? I'll bet you Peter Kokot would be pretty amenable to just saying no to that, but should they hear from us in some way? Should you hear from us?
If we can get consensus on what it is that we want to say, then yeah, well, we've seen in the past that there is some effect based on our advocacy, so we have to be careful with our advocacy, but yeah, I mean, develop consensus on how that would be, what it would be, I think, right? I don't think you'd have a problem.
So I'm not a commissioner. I mean, this is where I kind of toss it out to you guys, because I'm not actually, you know, I'm not a voting member, so.
But, I mean, the tricky part is we haven't had an opportunity to discuss what the ramifications of this are, and we haven't heard from the advocates, so.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, that's what makes me a little nervous.
Okay. So maybe it's just too short a time.
Might be.
I think there are models of the Sierra Club and some other places have put out position statements on the omnibus bill and the rate tariff piece. So I think there are models of things that we could consider, and we could turn them around fairly quickly if we're interested in doing that. I think it's a good idea. I think, you know, why do we have a planning commission if we can't try and influence something at the state level? But it would take some. It would mean that somebody on the commission, or you know, Chris, you could craft something based on maybe some of the models that are out there. We could pass it around and get something done fairly quickly.
So, I mean, the one model that is out there that I know of is, this is basically a template that's being passed around for people. And I don't know if the Energy Commission wanted to do it. It says, let me read it to you, it's really short. Greeting constituents of Representative X, the House Omnibus Energy Bill release is expected very shortly, likely this week. It's likely a vote will be scheduled within 12 hours of release, not allowing much time for legislators to hear from their constituents. Therefore, we urge you to contact Representative X as soon as possible by calling that number and stating clearly that you want him or her to vote no if the bill contains a gas pipeline tax tariff. And then there's a few reasons. The reason we are so strongly opposed to the pipeline tax tariff is that it will burden us with paying for fossil fuel infrastructure that we don't want and don't need, and keep us dependent on polluting fossil fuels for many, many more years. What we want and are willing to pay for is a rapid transition to clean energy. Your representative was among 97 who signed a letter to the House leaders urging them not to include a pipeline tax tariff in legislation. If leadership ignores this majority of House members, it should be prepared to have its omnibus energy bill defeated until that provision is excluded. Please forward this message to other constituents of Representative X so that his or her office is flooded with calls. So that's the message that goes out. And I have a copy of that. Where is it? Had a copy of that letter. Actually,
does Climate Action Network have a position?
No, this is a different letter I'm talking about. Yeah, Climate Action Network is the one that's basically sending this round. That's basically their position. So, I mean, if the Energy Commission, and I totally hear what you guys are saying, if you don't have time to digest this, I guess what I would say is, commissioners individually, you know, you guys are all welcome to do what you. Which you can. Any other comments on this or feedback, discussion? Wanted to bring it to the commission's notice. Hearing none, I'm going to go on to the carbon fee and rebates bill. Right now, the carbon fee and rebate bill is in the Transportation, Utilities, and Energy Commission subcommittee. And so here's an update from someone who's been tracking that. Both Senator Barrett's bill and Senator Pacheco's bill, real briefly, the only difference basically between them is Pacheco would spend some of the money for transportation infrastructure, whereas Barrett would refund any money that comes in through this fee back to the mass, back to everybody. It would not fund any state action whatsoever. It would just be a feedback through. Both bills were extended in Joint Telecommunications, Utilities, and Energy Committee to July 1st. That's very positive. In the short term, the statewide coalition campaign for clean energy future is seeking to get legislation released to the Senate from that subcommittee and then an up or down Senate vote this session. And I'm hearing getting a vote, even if it's a negative vote, getting a vote this session kind of moves it forward for the next legislative session, so it would be helpful. Longer term, we need to influence the state reps. In our local area, reps Cocott, Story, Sivek, did I pronounce that right?
Mm-hmm.
Vega, and Kulik signed the attached letter supporting it. Senator Downing is supportive. Senators Lesser and Welch aren't yet visible, but they are likely will vote for it. Actually, since then, I've heard that Welch is for it. Over the midterm and longer term, next session, the areas in the valley where we need to enlist more support are the business community, farmers, and neighboring representatives who are leaning to support but haven't yet come out. Mentioned a few of them. And then, not knowing what the Energy Commission can do, this person suggested that what could be helpful is educating the business communities, farmers, and neighboring representatives. So perhaps a forum that the Energy Commission could co-sponsor targets, which targets these groups, could be good.
For example, an event initiating the farm food community that is co-sponsored by your commission, and a few others. So that's, I think, just to kind of put it out there for consideration. This is not urgent. This is going to go into the next legislative session. Hopefully, if it gets voted in the Senate, it's going to go in with a little bit stronger legs into the next legislative session. But that's kind of long-term planning, so I thought I would bring this to the commission just to consider.
One of the things I've heard about that bill is that the big pushback is around the fear that it's going to raise gasoline prices significantly in Massachusetts. Mm-hmm. And that's why a number of people that might support it otherwise are concerned about it. So that could be pushback that we hear from people in Northampton,
right.
I would imagine, and certainly businesses.
Right. I do know that part of the bill is structured, or at least we should double check this, but I know that it's supposed to be. That part of the bill is to be structured that people that live in more rural areas would get a larger feedback. So they basically to offset the increased driving that they do. That's one way of kind of countering that, trying to alleviate that. But
gas is so low right now, this is the time to do it.
Right. Yeah, my personal opinion is that that is probably the best thing that we can do to avoid climate change is to start putting the price on carbon. But that's me. Okay, anything else on state legislation? I have one last item, kind of a fun one. The Hitchcock Center for the Environment is currently working with Northampton's the fourth grade class at Jackson Street School on a clean energy curriculum. And I know this because the person running it gave me a call to see whether I could give them some information to fill them in on what Northampton is doing. And I'm going to provide that with them. I'm bringing it up with you guys because I thought, wow, opportunity for presentations in class to bring in people who are active in Northampton. And if anybody's interested, I would be happy to give you a connection to Mickey McKinley is her name. And the reason Mickey called me was that I'm actually the person that wrote the curriculum.
There you go.
That the Hitchcock Center has adopted and is now using it and has been using it for years. So that's the reason she called me.
Have you suggested they make a class trip to our meeting sometime?
That's not fair. That'd be cruel.
Poor children.
Yes, exactly. If you want to discourage children from any government involvement, the last thing you want to do is make them sit through a meeting on an uncomfortable chair.
Unless, of course, we have cake.
Cake and balloons, which I'm all for. Yeah. Pie, I would suggest. But
there you go, I like that.
I think you should go first.
I'd be happy to.
Okay.
I think you and Aiden would be the stars in the marriage.
My son will be in fourth grade next year, so.
Maybe they'll do it again.
Well, I don't think he's going to show up.
No, nothing more boring.
Fourth grade might be okay. Fourth grade is still okay.
He grows up like the sun, so he wouldn't recognize
it. There you go. Some kind of.
So with that, I think we're on to the agenda, unless someone else has something.
I move the wager.
Great.